All right. Hello, everyone. Got my panelists jumping back in here. All right. Welcome, everyone, to our Preview Pitzer Essay Writing Workshop. I'm so glad to have you here, and thank you for sharing all of your introductions in the chat. It's good to see that we're coming from all over the world today, it seems. So super awesome. My name is Alex Morse. I'm an admission counselor here at Pitzer College. This is my third year as an admission counselor at Pitzer, and I'm very excited to be co-facilitating our event tonight. I will now prompt our panelists to do some introductions, and I will start with Andrea Scott. Oh, you're muted.
Hi, everybody. My name is Andrea Scott. I'm Associate Professor for Academic Writing at Pitzer, and I also direct the Writing Center. And I'm really excited about this conversation. It's one of my passions is to talk about writing and to structure conversations in a way that set everybody up for success in their writing projects. So welcome.
All right, Nikki.
Hi, everyone. My name is Nikki. I am a senior at Pitzer, pursuing a self-design major in education and community engagement with a minor in Asian American studies. And I am also a writing fellow. And like Andrea said, I'm really excited to work with you all today.
Awesome. And lastly, Duan Duan.
Hi, everyone. My name is Duan Duan Xie. I'm an admission counselor at Pitzer. I work with Alex in terms of reading applications and reading all of your essays, and I can't wait to do that starting soon. I will be here helping out in the Q&A box. If you do have any questions throughout this event, feel free to pop that into the Q&A box down below.
All right, yes, and we do have another Writing Center fellow with us here. Em, if you can turn on your video and introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm actually just pulling into my driveway, so I'm in the car right now and can't turn on my video, but my name is Em, and I'll shortly be in facial fullness, but I'm Em, I use she, they pronouns. I'm an environmental sociology major with a double major in Spanish, and I'm also a writing fellow because I think that the power of storytelling is absolutely something that I want to help other students, incoming students, to utilize. So I'm really excited to meet some of you all and hope that we can be helpful in this process.
All right, awesome. Thank you, Em. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and get us started with just going over the plan for the evening. So we're going to be having a few methods of audience participation tonight. There are quite a few of you, so it's a little bit of a trick to get it right, but we have some plans. We'll be asking your opinion via poll a couple of times, so you definitely want to have your phone or your computer up ready to open another link and do a poll. We will occasionally ask you to share your thoughts in the chat box, which is the very box you're using right now to introduce yourselves to us. And then lastly, we will be using the Q&A box on Zoom. So if you have a question that you want to get answered, make sure you put that in the Q&A box, because in the chat, it can just get buried and we'll never see it. If you put it in the Q&A box, that gives us power to be able to mark it for us to talk about it later. So just FYI about those different functionalities for participating. We'll be reading some real sample essays tonight from students who were admitted to Pitzer. And so you'll have the chance to get to look at those and also hear us talk about what makes them work. We will be giving a lot of guidance just throughout this session, talking about the process of writing your Pitzer essay and how to produce a good product. And then lastly, I just want to let everyone know that this session will be recorded. So you can take notes if you would like, but also if you would rather just sort of sit back and listen, you can look for that recording in your email in the next couple of weeks. So you will have access to this information later. All right, so with that, I think we can go ahead and turn things over to Andrea here to get us started with our first audience participation activity.
Great, so you all have been thinking a lot about the college essay right now, I imagine. It's part of the reason why you're here tonight. And one of the things that I love about workshops like this is it's an opportunity for us to pool together our collective wisdom, because you already know a lot about the features of a good college essay. So I'd like everybody to take just a moment and reflect and just enter a few key words, maybe just one or two or three key words in the poll about what you think the features are of a good college essay. What comes to mind for you? And what will happen is a word cloud is going to be generated based on your responses. So we're already seeing eloquent.
Yes, and I see people putting answers in the chat, but just FYI, those you want to go and put them into the poll everywhere at pollev.com/AndreaScott997. So make sure you get your answers in the poll and not just in the chat so we can get it in our word cloud.
Right. And I actually love this feature because it's very democratic, right? So it takes all of your responses and then the votes, the words that are emerging the most have the most weight visually on the screen. And so again and again, I'm seeing a lot of shifting around as more responses come in. But I see as the largest keyword right now is authentic, which strikes me as just very, very insightful, right? So I feel like sometimes with a college essay, we feel like we have to have a story that's big, that's transformative, that's larger than life, but actually sort of taking some time out and reflecting, what are your values? What have brought you to this place? What are the set of experiences that form a coherent narrative about why you want to be at Pitzer now at this particular moment in time, right? In the midst of a pandemic, there are all kinds of important, exciting, and interdisciplinary questions to ask. If you're true to that and dig deep into that, that's going to make your essay really, really great. And personal is emerging also, right, as a large keyword here too, right? That a good college essay is personal, right? It's something we shouldn't read the college essay and think that we could plug in any name, right? It should sound like you and the unique story that you have. And I think it takes a kind of quiet confidence to trust that. But when you do, and when you step back and you reflect, and you do tell your narrative, right, of what you've done and how that aligns with the values of the college, that in and of itself is compelling. So I want to open things up to our panelists, to Alex or Nikki. Are there other keywords that you see that resonate with you when you think of a good college essay?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of good stuff going in here. I'm seeing a lot of stuff related to writing and just writing quality, you know, well written, specific is an incredibly good word that I see that's popped up here already, engaging. So I think that these, you know, the comments that you've made about the quality of the writing, very important as well. I do want to add that I think it's interesting that unique is coming up here as one of the most prominent words, because it's almost funny to think that, you know, that it's more important that you be unique than you be yourself, right? I think that a lot of students worry about their essay just sounding like every other, you know, essay that we might be reading in the college process, which is an understandable concern. But I definitely want to reassure everyone that like your story and your voice is, you know, inherently unique because it's unique to you. So just FYI about that. This is very cool though. It seems to be slowing down a little bit.
Is there anything you would add, Nikki? Because one of the things that that we want you to apply to Pitzer and to come to Pitzer, but one of the, you know, sometimes people think, if I just write this college essay, then I'm done. Actually, this kind of writing that you're doing is preparing you for all kinds of important writing that you'll do at Pitzer. And a lot of fellows in our writing center work with seniors who are writing personal statements also for fellowships, and they have to do the same process of really digging deep and reflecting on who they are, who's the person behind this project, right? Who's the person behind this passion, and how to convey that in a narrative. And I know Nikki's worked with a lot of our seniors and is also thinking about the college experience right now. So what are you seeing?
Yeah, I know that you touched on this already, Andrea, but when you're talking about values and really understanding like what your values are and also what your own interests are and your passions and what you want to really get into when you're in college. I found, especially in doing some fellowship writing and like just reflecting and finding things now beginning like the very brink of my, like the job search, and having to really reflect on what my passions are, like going back and seeing kind of these brainstorms or these webs that I had done for my college essay to be like tremendously helpful. Because I used, like, those were really like, that was for me the foundation of trying to understand myself holistically, as well as like the many parts that I'm made of. So I definitely do like want to echo the value, not only the essay itself, but also the work that goes into that, both in the process as well as the outcome and how you then kind of see your own personal journey really grow and take mm-hmm. like.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, are we ready to do our next participation activity?
Sure. I just want to give Em a chance to chime in
quickly. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, if you have some, if you see something that resonates with.
Sure, I really appreciate that, Andrea, because I was actually thinking, like one of the words that's really small in this one right now that I think is actually really huge is community. I think in writing these essays, like, I mean, the most important thing, at least from my perspective, that admissions is looking for is how you're going to contribute to the community and be a part of that community. How are you going to fit in with the Pitzer community? So I think that's a really huge thing to keep in mind when writing this, because, you know, this is ultimately, you know, about seeing who you are as an individual and how you fit in with the system as a whole. So just wanted to say that piece.
Yeah, you make a great point. You could take the words right out of my mouth. That's perfect.
Okay, so fantastic. So I'm going to pivot us to the next activity. So we've brainstormed a bit sort of broadly about what are the qualities of a good essay. And now I want you to think a little bit about why they're so hard to write, right? So now we have a broad sense of everybody's perspective on what makes the essay good, but why are they hard? Why is that hard? Why is that hard to produce an essay that's personal, right? That's authentic, that imagines you as a member of a broader community that cares about a set of questions.
Yes, and while those answers are coming in, Andrea, are you ready to take over screen share?
Yes, absolutely.
All right, I'll stop sharing.
Great, so can you now, okay, great. Fantastic. So Nikki, you can go ahead and read some things that you're seeing emerge in the chat. I know it's a quick and fast read, and you can chime in as well. So, oopsie-daisy, my keyboard is starting to move without me. So why are good college essays so hard to write? What were some responses that we?
So the two responses that popped up on my screen first were from Abigail and Tyler, both very similar. Abigail said, it's hard to convey what you're feeling into words. And then Tyler said, it's hard to capture who you are, who I am in 600 words. So definitely like the word limit. Trying to seem interesting, sharing vulnerable aspects of yourself.
Mm-hmm. I'm seeing a lot about like perfectionism, so pressure to be perfect and to do it a certain way.
So I thought what we would do is I'm just going to collect a bunch of responses, and then I'm going to invite all of our panelists to just chime in with some advice about those different things. These are all really terrific, and they definitely resonate with my experience of everything I write. So, other things that are challenging?
I've seen some about having to do this sort of personal essay, even though they're used to academic writing. So some challenges with that.
Yeah, so maybe a lot of our training with writing is writing in a particular genre, right? An academic essay, and then suddenly you're being asked to shift and write in this really reflective, introspective mm-hmm. way. Okay. Maybe a few more and then we'll start to.
There's this one that really struck me. Anna said, it's hard to think of yourself objectively and make a good story structure out of your life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is really, I think that's really insightful too, right? Because part of it, I'm just gonna start to dive in, right? So with this last one, part of it is through the process of writing, you discover things, right? So a lot of the anxiety for me is before I start, because I feel like, this is again, the perfectionism, right? Oh, I've seen sample essays. I kind of know what I'm supposed to do. And I need to produce that. And every sentence needs to look like that the first time through. And also just, there's Jerome Bruner is a theorist of narrative. And he talks about narrative as a meaning-making activity, right? So through the process of writing, you discover things about yourself. And I think this goes back to sort of Nikki and Em's point too, about this process of writing these essays, it feels like high pressure and professional, but it's also this moment to really reflect and to tell your story and to own it. And by trusting that and writing that out, you discover things and you can always go back and write. For me, the hardest thing is getting started. I have to set a timer and tell myself I'm just going to write for 25 minutes and then come back to it, because I know the hardest part is starting, because I know I'm not going to like what I first wrote, but I know I need to give myself space to warm up. So I have to warm up a lot until I get to that rhythm where I'm like, oh, this feels like me. Like, it feels like I'm actually tapping into who I am, and this feels like my voice, right? So when you're writing and something doesn't feel like your voice, it means you're not relaxed enough. So try to make writing fun and write so that it sounds like you. I've interviewed hundreds of people for different fellowship grants. And the thing that I learned too is that you don't have to be someone else. You don't have to be special. You have to be you. And owning you is actually really powerful, right? So I would say start. Anybody else want to chime in and respond to one of these statements you see about why it's so hard to write these essays? What resonates for you, for our panelists here?
Yes, and I want to add one more that I saw a couple of times, and I actually hear a lot from students, which is a fear of bragging about yourself or being narcissistic. So on the flip side of perfectionism, I suppose. I think that for me as an admission counselor, I'll just speak to the fear of bragging since we're right there. I want to tell you that the admission process is your place to brag. This is the place where you can really talk yourself up, you know, put yourself on display and say, here's all the wonderful things that I have to offer this college. And you don't have to worry about us thinking, oh, that's kind of self-involved, you know, kind of narcissistic. We as admission counselors will never think that about you because we've asked you to write this essay. So I definitely really like to affirm that one, because I think, especially depending on like what kind of house you were raised in, what kind of school you come from, maybe you're not raised in a way where you're taught to brag about yourself and point out your good qualities. And this is a space where you absolutely can. Yeah, take up space. I was about to say that and you wrote it on the screen. So that would be my admission comment on that.
Great. What have any of our other panelists struggled with either being concise or just the sort of self-consciousness that comes with trying to seem interesting, or that comes also with making ourselves vulnerable, right? There's, because we all want to be seen, right? And we all want to feel that connection with our reader, and that the risk is you make yourself vulnerable, but you don't feel heard, or it's not coming across right in the way that you. It's not conveying what you're feeling in words, right? So what do our panelists, what advice do our panelists have to offer about those challenges?
I'm still reflecting on that question, but what I can say that I do resonate with is, so my brother actually is also a senior in high school, like all of you, or many of you, I assume. And he just finished writing his college essays, and I had been kind of in the backseat of him doing all of this, and having also had this experience of writing personal essays, I really felt for him and feel for you all in terms of that, yeah, that struggle of wanting to really convey an aspect of yourself that feels true to you and also that you're proud of, but also there can be that fear or just that uncertainty of opening yourself up potentially to people who you don't know. I think that this is, to be transparent, this is something that I also struggle with, like, to this day, even like as a senior in college. So I guess like one thing that I say for myself, as well as for everyone who might be struggling with this, that it's okay to feel this way. I don't feel like I have much constructive feedback to say about this, other than if you are telling a story or writing an essay that you feel proud of, that's what's most important. It sounds very cliche, but I do feel for you on that.
Yeah, that it's hard, that it's actually part of the process itself. And did you want to add something?
Sure, yeah. I think that everyone has had some really good things to say so far. And I'm just struck by hearing all of the comments and feeling this sense of deja vu and anxiety and understanding totally where you're at. I completely remember during this process all of those fears. So yeah, I feel for you. It's it's going to go a lot better than you're probably imagining. And you know, I think inherently, like what story needs to be told. And I think that the best tool you have for finding that story is to just free write. And I tell this to all of our to all of the people I work with at the Writing Center, like, if you don't know where to start, don't edit yourself. Like, whatever the prompt brings up in you, even if it doesn't feel like an appropriate story for the actual application itself, just free write it, get it down on the page, get whatever is coming up for you out there. And then from there, then you can always go back and find what themes are arising the most and channel it into whatever story is meant to be for this essay. But that's my biggest advice, is don't edit yourself preemptively. You can do that later. There's plenty of time for editing yourself.
I just want to hop on that really quickly and also advocate for mind maps and webs. If you're a visual learner, like I am, and probably a lot of people are, I find that to be such an amazing resource. You can also do like post-it webs and things where you are actively seeing in front of you all of the different stories and all of the different parts of yourself. And that in addition to free writing can if you avoid the temptation to edit yourself, can be a really, really wonderful resource.
Yeah, and that's definitely the advice that I give students when they're worried about the word limit, is I tell them to just write an essay that's too long. Start there, because you can go through and you can cut and you can, I did this as a 17-year-old, use sticky notes and be like, here's the different pieces that I have in, here's what I'm going to take out. It's very hard to write if you're like, it needs to be 600 words right now. You know, you're going to struggle to produce something.
Yeah, great. So I think all of this is great. And this is a nice segue into our next section. And I wanted to say something quickly before we go there too. Like this thing about, because we didn't really get into this vulnerability part, except that it's normal and that we all feel it. I feel like too, sometimes we feel like we have to have, like our story isn't enough. And I feel like actually like going to that place that's vulnerable and being really honest about it actually makes for a more interesting narrative, right? So I feel like if we are trying to tell someone else's story or to have this narrative of triumph, like of progress, of linear progress, like our lives often aren't like that, right? And when you tell a story that that has some complexity in it, that really showcases you honestly and doesn't exaggerate, but also doesn't undersell yourself, like, but it's just really honest and sincere, like that, that's powerful, right? That's enough. Okay, so we've talked kind of abstractly. You're like all going, maybe you're all thinking, I know this, right? Like, also I say, as a Writing Center director, go have other people read your work. And like those supportive people in your life who will say, ask them what's interesting and have them tell you about what's interesting in your essay, and then like, go back and play that up. But what sounds most like you? So yeah, but I want us to actually kind of drill down a bit and get into, I'm gonna stop sharing.
Yes.
Okay, great. Have us actually, drill down a bit and like go concrete, right? Because I feel like the writing person in me is always, what's scary is what we haven't seen, right? And so we want to talk concretely about two essays that you know, were written by students who were successfully admitted into Pitzer College, and just talk about them. What are they doing, right? How are they enacting these things like vulnerability, right? These things like being authentic in ways that you find compelling, right? So we're going to take a moment, but before I do that, I want to turn things over to Alex, because another thing that I like to tell my students whenever they're writing anything is know your reader. And Alex and Duan are like your readers, and they're in the room, and so you're going to get the inside scoop. They've read thousands of essays, so Alex is going to talk to you a bit about her perspective on the college essay.
Yes, yeah, and Andrea is not joking when she says we've read thousands of essays. That is actually true. So the main thing I want to say here is that I'm reading your application very quickly. So I think that's something that you as a student and I, when I was a student, underestimated, because you put so much time into it, right? You take a long time putting together that Common App, writing this essay, gathering all the materials. And so the idea that someone might read your essay in a few seconds, you're like, wait, a few seconds, you know, that doesn't seem like enough time, right? And so we really are reading your applications, reading your essays rather quickly. When you're in my position and you're reading typically about 60 of these essays a day between Common App and Pitzer Supplement essays, the way that I read essays at this point is like, I kind of just look at them. And initially the first thing I do is like topic sentences, main things that stick out. And I'm like kind of just absorbing it all in one moment. And then my brain will be like, okay, now I'm going to read it through. I'll skim it pretty quickly. If there's something that I find particularly notable, I will stop on that thing and maybe read it a little more in depth and think it over. But for the most part, I'm reading really quickly. And so the thing that I like to convey to students is that it's very important that your thesis of your essay and then the pieces of that of your argument or your story that you're telling are very clear and are well outlined. So that's one of the main things I like to tell students is that when we read your essays, we're frequently reading them kind of like a sponge. Like I'm kind of just like looking at it and then taking it in a way that is really hard to explain, honestly. The other point that I wanted to make about just sort of like the audience and, you know, who, what I'm taking from your essay. So although when I do that initial read, it's really quick, right? Like I just said, when I go to committee later, I actually will utilize your essay a lot if I'm trying to get you in. And so I often like to say that as admission counselors, we are your advocates. So we are there to gather all of the evidence that we have about you, take them to the committee and say, this is why I think this student should be admitted to Pitzer College. So even though the first read is quick, and so you might be like, why would I put effort into it if you're only going to read it really quickly? It's because later down the line, when we're having a conversation about you in that committee room, I can put that essay up on the screen and say, look at these points, look at these things. Frequently for the students that I'm hoping to admit, I will go back and I will highlight the pieces of their essay that I found particularly relevant or powerful. So it really is quite important later. You have to give me the receipts to say like, this is why this student should get into Pitzer College. So that's my quick spiel on sort of what I'm using the essay for and what I get out of it. And also to let you know that it is quite a unique process in that you're being reviewed really quickly. So important to know. But yes, I will start the screen share again now so we can get into the sample essay portion of our workshop here. And so I just wanted to say that Pitzer has three prompts that you can choose from when it comes to writing your Pitzer supplement essay. The reason we've chosen this prompt for our example essays is because this is the most common prompt that gets submitted. Reason being is we used to only have this as the only prompt. So I think a lot of students, it's just a holdover over the last couple of years that most people tend to gravitate towards this. There are two other essay prompts you can choose from, but just FYI, we won't really be talking about them tonight, but all of the principles we talk about here are applicable to those as well. Prompt is up on the screen. It basically asks about which of our core values you've engaged with and in what way. And then I will go ahead and drop a link in the chat for you here. Or actually, Duan, if you could maybe pull out that Google Doc link for them, because I don't want to disrupt the screen share. But if you are not reading in the Google Doc, we're also going to have the essays up on the screen. Give everybody a second here to get oriented. All right, and I think we'll just, thank you, Duan, much appreciated. So we're going to have Nikki read this first essay aloud for us.
Let me just get a little closer so my eyes can see this. I have not so great eyes, I have a very strong prescription. Anyways, so sample essay number one, student engagement. Reflecting on my high school career, I realized that although I engage in several of the Pitzer's core values, the one that stands out more than others is student engagement. Student engagement has been a strong interest of mine, not only while attending high school, but in my community at large. It is important for me to continue this work and continue to develop this passion while attending Pitzer, where I know I would be able to engage and be exposed to intercultural understanding. In high school, I am a part of the medical program and vice president of our HOSA club, which helps me engage with student engagement. Being the vice president, my key responsibility is to conduct blood drives at my school. We collected blood from 149 people, meaning that we saved a total of 447 lives, three of which came from my donation. I felt that this was a huge accomplishment for me being in a leadership position and my club as we were able to meet our goals by engaging with the students and our community in order to save others. Equally as important, would be the feeling of growth I experienced. Understanding that I was going to save the lives of people around the world motivated me to donate. In addition to being engaged as a student outside of the classroom, I am very well-rounded inside of the classroom as well. One thing that expresses my engagement as a student is being core IB. I chose to go core IB because I get to learn and apply the knowledge from those classes to my everyday life. One of my greatest accomplishments has been writing my 4,000 word extended essay for one of my IB classes. The subject I chose was literature. I compared Nora from the play A Doll's House to Ferdows from the novel Woman at Point Zero. It was exciting to showcase my intelligence and to demonstrate that I know how to apply the knowledge from other classes and to one paper and organize it flawlessly. I felt like I was already a college student. This was a huge accomplishment for me and really showed how engaged I am within my classes and shows how well-rounded I am as a student. Another way that I show my engagement as a student is joining an organization called American Scholars. I was chosen from over 2,800 plus high school juniors who applied to the program. In American Scholars, I get mentors and a college counselor and have meetings with them to assist me in my college process. In fact, Pitzer is one of the American Scholars Platinum partners. Being an American Scholar and exceeding in my higher level classes means a lot to me. I've always grown up in an environment full of minorities, hence the fact that I have not been able to engage with the intercultural understanding value. Lastly, I have shown student engagement through my desire to help people. Feeding the homeless was something I'd never forget, understanding how fortunate I am to be able to help and see the smiles on their faces. What was most valuable was being able to take time to get to know them personally and hear their stories help me to develop as a person. I'm continuing some of this work now in high school while working at my local hospital. It is exciting that I get to continue the work I started in middle school by helping kids and families and promote health and wellness for my community. Ultimately, Pitzer is my top choice for college, and I believe that it is because it best fits me and my personality as a student and as a leader. I want to change the schema of America by applying the knowledge from Pitzer to my city.
All right, thank you very much. That is our first sample essay, and we will be having Em read our second sample essay.
All right, I like this essay. A few years ago, if you looked at the plot of land surrounding my high school, you half expected tumbleweed to blow through. Despite living in a beautiful region with many native plants, my school's landscaping was full of invasive ivy and arid dirt. This problem became a springboard for my engagement with Pitzer's core value of environmental sustainability. When my science teacher, Mrs. Johnson, approached me with a project to make the school's landscaping sustainable, I was eager to help. I was enrolled in her class, Physics, Alternative Energy Design and Construction, and she asked me to work on the project after seeing how engaged I was in class and how passionate I am about environmental sustainability. The project required grant funding, so I began researching plant choices and irrigation options to submit to Mrs. Johnson for her grant proposal. I looked exclusively at drought-tolerant plants, with an emphasis on California natives. Additionally, I researched which irrigation setups would best conserve water, an important issue at all times, but especially at the height of the California drought. Mrs. Johnson used my research in her proposal, which got us the needed grant. Then, on a Saturday afternoon, students and faculty worked together to tear out the deep-rooted ivy. I was one of those students, falling flat on my back as I yanked on the tough vines. Despite the aching muscles and the dirt under our nails, at the end of the day, we were all smiling at our progress. A few months later, I was asked to give a speech at a ceremony dedicating the project to a beloved science teacher, Charlotte Willoughby, who had died. As I spoke to peers, teachers, administrators, parents, and community mentors, members, I could already see the legacy we were leaving in the green shoots peeking out of the mulch. After the landscaping project was completed, I took on another sustainability initiative. The year before, Mrs. Johnson's students had constructed solar ovens to be sent to remote areas for use in place of wood fires for cooking. She asked me to lead other students in researching how to use the solar ovens in various conditions and developing recipes tailored for solar ovens. After compiling our research and recipes, the ovens and cooking instructions were sent to Native American reservations where they are currently in use. Additionally, the solar oven project provided a way to educate others on sustainable energy sources. The high school was hosting a makers fair where students and parents could present their projects to the community. With the help from students I recruited, my teacher and I displayed our solar ovens. We handed out s'mores, along with a water turbine, a design project from her class, which generates sustainable energy from moving water. With these projects, I engaged the elementary schoolers in activities that educated them about conserving resources. When the fair came to a close, we were covered in melted marshmallow and grease from the turbine gears. But my group and I were already planning what to bring next year. As I exit high school, I know I will be leaving behind a more sustainable community. Students enjoy lunch in the Charlotte Willoughby Garden, and I regularly see the AP Environmental Science class there studying plant species. The solar ovens are being used instead of environmentally damaging wood fires. Elementary schoolers ran up to me after the Makers Fair saying that they want to be scientists after playing with our projects. As I continue on to college, I would love the opportunity to be involved in Pitzer groups such as A Cleaner Tomorrow. With ACT, I could continue to encourage kids to be tomorrow's environmental activists. Through this and other efforts, I plan to keep working to make the world more environmentally sustainable. After all, we don't have Planet B.
All right, thank you, Em. So Duan Duan is gonna go ahead and activate a Zoom poll now. If everyone could go ahead and select which essay was your favorite of the two that we read. And then once you've responded to the poll, you can also start to put some reasons why you chose that essay in the chat. Make sure to put which essay you chose in the chat as well. So like essay one because, essay two because, just because we want to be able to distinguish them. We'll give everyone a second to vote and put their answers in the chat. And while we're doing that, Andrea, I'm going to let you take over screen share. All right, we got everybody's answers coming in. Thank you everybody for your responses. And then I think we can go ahead and start just feeding Andrea some of the answers that we're getting in the chat. And Duan Duan, I think we can probably close the poll here in just a second so we can get our poll results.
Yeah, so I'm seeing an overwhelming positive response to, essay two. Let's see. Essay two showed a lot of growth and was really authentic. Essay two was a more interesting read. Essay two felt more cohesive while remaining varied and fresh with each paragraph.
Essay two expressed specifics that were engaging and reflective.
Essay two, because I love how they were able to display how they connect to sustainability with an event that happened.
essay two was more storytelling oriented, so told as a story. And then I'm seeing for essay one, some people are saying it was just clunkier. Mm-hmm. And someone saying the first one felt like a list instead of an essay. Essay one had some errors. We have some people choosing essay one. They felt it was especially genuine.
Adrienne, I think you might be muted.
Thanks so much. I was just thinking the other day that I missed microphones because people would like pat on them and say, are they on? And then I was like, wait, we have a version of that with Zoom, with the mute button. I'm always that person on the mute, on the Zoom. Yeah, so again, like, I think this is a terrific list. And so I want us to, again, dig deep into that, right? So, like, what does that look like on the page, right? So this is where I'm going to rely on my panelists to sort of unpack this. And also, if you have some ways of chiming in the chat, that would be really great, right? So it sounds like most of you voted for the second essay on sustainability, that you felt that was stronger. We have a long list here, showed growth, it was authentic, more interesting to read, cohesive, well varied, engaged specifics, engaging, reflective, right? It's more storytelling oriented. So then the question is, what does that look like on the page, right? So why? Where did you see something like, I don't know, what engaging is a word that's come up as a key word here, right? In two places. Like, what about the writing makes it more engaged or storytelling or storytelling oriented? Anybody want to chime in? Like, where do you see this, like, on the page? Like, can you be specific and drill down into the essay itself?
Yeah, I think that right off the bat, I would say that essay two was it focused more on like one overarching story and then another story within that, as opposed to just sort of listing out different things. But I think that that focus and that specificity definitely helped it to be more engaging.
Yeah, absolutely. So like the second one is, yeah, it's genuine, right? The students owning their experience and providing evidence of all the wonderful things that they've done to set themselves up for success in college. And there's evidence there. But the second one really starts with this story of the garden, right? Is this really short opening hook that pulls you in, this really beautiful, vivid image. Like, I was like, oh, that was so beautifully crafted, right? That probably never was in the first draft. Right? Like, and it pulls into the story of like this garden with this invasive species, and then how the student did research on that. And then the research became part of a grant that actually got funded, and it became like a living part of the landscape of the place. And then the student took that to a science fair, and it became not just research, but about teaching in the community, right? So that's the key, is like, all of your example, choose your examples wisely is what I tell students. This is why this is so valuable, this form of writing for fellowship writing, because you want that example to actually pull you into the story that's connected. So we feel like whenever we're moving through the parts of the story, it's a narrative. We're getting a different aspect, right? The story's becoming more complex, right? Instead of it being like a list where it sounds kind of like a resume. And one person asked, I saw in the chat room, like, how do you know if something feels cliche, right? Like in the beginning too. I think this is where it's really good to have someone else read something and tell you, like, is that a cliche? Because like Planet B, right? You know, it's a little bit like, ta-da-da, you know, like it's cute. It works. But if there were like bad puns, like everywhere, like maybe it wouldn't work, you know what I mean? But so that's where it's really useful to get a reader, but really being skillful about your examples, right? That you're using that example strategically to set up a narrative, right? Think of all the things a student could have written about sustainability in all their science research. So you think about yourself and what is that one thing that's going to lead us down this line of inquiry that's going to pull your reader along and really get them interested. Other things that you found effective? So our panelists in the room, the things that you really admire. This is, I always say, read things to beg, borrow, and steal, right? Like things that you're like, oh, that's really nice. Like, I really think that that's a skillful move.
Yeah, I was really compelled by the colorful and descriptive language that the author in SH2 used. I know that for some people, like for some writers, that kind of comes naturally, and for other people, it can be a little, it might not necessarily come as naturally to come up with these types of sensory details the way that this author did. But something that I think really helped additionally was that they were able to show and not tell. There was an example that Arlen gave in the chat, in the essay, they said, kids ran up to me after and said they wanted to be scientists too. And so like recounting and conveying the experience of what it was like to to receive those reactions, other than they said saying, showing or telling and saying something to the effect of the kids who were there enjoyed it. And I think that showing and telling, in addition to having very descriptive writing, I mean, colorful like language, both can work very beautifully. I think that showing and not telling is, at least in my opinion, a much, I guess if I had to choose between the two, that's the one that I think I would, that's the tool and the skill that I would want to really like work with the most, especially because I hope, at least to me, it seems that that might be a more accessible skill that people can practice and work on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I want to just chime in quickly before I forget the point too, because Nikki, what you were saying reminded me of a question that came up earlier is like, how do I not brag, right? And Alex is like, no, brag away, like take up space. But one way to like do that skillfully is to show and not tell, right? So the other essay would say, yeah, I was like, it felt really good to write an intelligent essay, or to, you know, like they use that kind of language, right? Like I'm a good, you know? And this essay didn't do that. It said, hey, like they talked about their research, like in that second paragraph, which described them. And then they said, yeah, and my teacher used the research in the proposal. So you're like, oh, that must've been good, right? Oh, your teacher tapped you for the proposal. Oh, you must've been good. She must've seen potential in you, right? Like she didn't say, I had such potential that my, you know, she just said what, you know, and it implies, right? It implies that's the evidence, right, for efficacy, right? So didn't say, oh, I had such a, you know, I was happy about this project that I did in the schools because it had impact. She described what she did with specificity and clarity, and then said the kids afterwards wanted to become scientists. So you're like, oh, it had impact. She doesn't need to tell you that, right? So that's what folks mean, I think, when they say show, don't tell. Because if you look at those opening statements, they're very declarative. There is that kind of confidence, right, as you're moving through the narrative. So there is a declarative statement, but in terms of evidence for success, it's citing the evidence instead of saying I was successful. You're citing the evidence that actually shows that, right? Em, do you have anything you want to highlight in this essay? Because you said you really liked it when you started to read it, and there was like pep in your voice when you were reading the final words. Like, what did you admire about the essay? And
well, I'm biased because I'm a total nature nerd. So I liked the core value that they chose, and talking about community gardening is like the way to my heart. So so that's my biased reason. But I think everyone touched on some pretty good points. One of the things that I saw repeated in the chat a few times about number two that was a good strategy was the varied essays. The varied sentence structure. Veronica said that, and then a few other people chimed in about that. I think that like that was something that stood out to me the most about the first essay that could have been improved upon pretty easily just with a little help from thesaurus.com, like just reusing certain words, just replacing them with different words, kind of varying the sentence structure a little bit would have been a really good way to just like easily kind of shift this a degree slightly more interestingly. So yeah, that's all I would add.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, so there's sort of the artfulness of the language. There's a rhythm, there's a music in that. Like you can hear the person's voice, right? So I always tell my students, like, if you hear the voice that, like, since the dawn of humankind, humanity has been questioning good and evil. Like if you hear that voice in your head, like, stop. Like you're not being true to yourself, right? Here it's like, oh, a few years ago, if you looked at the plot of land surrounding my high school, you half expected, right? There's confidence in that colloquiality there, right? You half expected a tumbleweed to blow through, right? Like this is the student's voice, right? There's a colloquialism in there that's us formal, and there's a craft. There's not the type, like the typos in the second one. It's showing that I've really crafted this. I really thought about this and holistically about my project and also how it fits into Pitzer. Wow, they're gonna be part of this club that's like one of like the gem clubs on campus, right? The ACT club. She does amazing work in schools in the community, right? So we're seeing fit communicated with that. She's not saying I'd be a great fit, right? It's like, I'm gonna do this one there, right? And I'm excited to be a Pitzer. So you can also see this thing. So yeah, so I think that this is all really, really great. I feel like that first essay we read was like a very good essay, right? And I kind of admire the assertiveness of this. I'm a good student, I'm smart. I'm like, go. Yeah, like I want all my students to be feeling that, right? The second one is actually from my perspective as someone who reads a lot of writing on campus in different contexts, Pitzer students are the best students that I've worked with in 20 years at this kind of writing, this kind of reflective, introspective, artful language, right? So you think it's just the personal essay, but it's the discipline, what we're really good at in the curriculum. So community engaged scholarship. It's about storytelling, like Em said. You have to be able to tell a story to help us become invested in your research. Anthropology, sociology, like a lot of qualitatively oriented scholars. You have to look at data, but you have to tell a story about it that's compelling and that's rich and that's vivid to get people to care, right? So I feel like this, what you're doing in these college essays is also really preparing you for the work at Pitzer. So I hope that even though it feels stressful and performative, that you, through that process of writing, you learn things about yourself and you get that confidence through that vulnerability and that owning of your story. And also know that this writing and the process you go through is gonna set you up for success once you're here. I'm teaching a first year seminar and I'm just like, I wanna send my students an avatar of a happy dance because they're just like doing such amazing work. So I just wanna put that out there so that you don't think this is just a hoop to jump through. It's actually an intellectual exercise that's gonna be really useful to you. So I think that's my part and we can.
Yeah, so I had a couple of things I wanted to add just based on what I'm seeing in the chat and the conversation we've been having. When you were talking about how in the second essay, the author's voice really comes through, one of the things that made me think of that the second essay does well also that is very beneficial for me as an admission counselor is that it really shows how that student moves through the world and how they make decisions by telling a story about a problem that they saw, an action they chose to take in relation to that problem, and the outcome from their action. So I kind of got to see a progression of when they look at a problem, do they think, oh, I want to change that. I want to take steps to do something about that. Are they working and collaborating with their community about that? So, you know, we talked about community. Em mentioned that earlier. Super powerful to see the way that this author engaged with the community in that essay. So that was just something that came to mind in terms of that student. I was really able to look at them and say, okay, I understand this person's values. I understand how they navigate the world. And I know that that will succeed here at Pitzer. So that's kind of like that key point that I will then take to the admission committee, right? And I do want to also say some stuff about essay one, because I know we've talked a lot about essay two, which is sort of the standout essay. Essay one did get into Pitzer College. So that is an essay that is still absolutely acceptable in terms of what we're looking for in our process. And I want to tell you what that essay did that was good, that is what I'm looking for, at least from, you know, a solid essay, even if it's not the standout, you know, with the artful writing and all of that. If you just manage to get something on paper that specifically addresses one core value, I frequently tell this to students, don't try and write about all five core values, pick one, maybe two, if you feel like there are two that go together. But really focusing in on one core value made that a stronger essay from my perspective. And then pretty obviously going through, like, although that list structure is not as ideal, it does get the job done in terms of getting the information out there. So if that's the place that you start with your Pitzer essay, is maybe more of a list structure of just like, what if I talk about this and this and this? I think that is a good starting place because that is getting the job done. And then if you want to try and shape it into more of a story and make it a little more artful, you know, that's something you can do too to try and bring it to the next level. But I just want to give some kudos to that first essay because it checks all the boxes in terms of the hard information that we need to see from students in order to admit them to the college. So I hope that that's helpful to you in case you're looking at this and you're freaking out and you're like, I can't write an artful essay. Like, I'm never going to be able to make this happen. Just keep in mind, it's a spectrum. There's lots of in between. Both of these are good essays and both of them were admitted to the college.
Yeah. Thanks so much for saying that. It just reminded me of something I wanted to say, Alex, which I felt like that first essay was like an earlier draft of the second essay. Right? Like if this student had been writing more drafts, like it would have been that second essay. And this is actually, this version is what I most often see when I'm advising students on fellowship writing. They almost always, like their second or their third draft and look something like this, what you've read. And then we're really crafting to get to that standout position. And what Alex said earlier is about how like the first read is really quick, but the second read is deeper, and then you're looking, you want to, like, I tell my students, I dramatize for them fellowship applications. I work with seniors, right? Like, you want to transform someone in like a minute or several minutes in or 15 minutes in into being your champion. And when you write the standout essay, you're really giving people the opportunity to champion you in the admissions process. So that's why we wanted to show you this, because there are a lot of very good essays. But the standout essay is the thing that will maximize your chances of having folks really fight for you in the room when there are limited spots for like a large pool of talent.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. So unless Nikki and Em, you have anything else you want to add? Looking good, looking good. So I think we're going to move into the Q&A portion here. And I see that there's already a good amount of questions in the chat. And so we can go ahead and get started in answering those. So I'm just going to, give me 1 second here. All right, so our first question for our panelists here is, does Pitzer get, oh, this question is for me, so I'm just gonna answer it. Does Pitzer get a lot of essays relating to environmentalism? Does this topic not land well? If so, how can we talk about environmentalism as a value in a more interesting way? Do we get a lot of essays about environmental sustainability? Absolutely, we definitely do. There's been an uptick, I would say, in the last few years of how many students that write about that. Does this topic not land well? No, it's amazing. Please send me your sustainability essays. We are very happy to read them. Because sustainability is one of Pitzer's core values, you don't need to worry about not being unique just because you're writing an essay about sustainability. We're definitely looking for students that are interested in that. So don't worry about not standing out just because you're also writing about sustainability. That's definitely going to happen in this process, and that is okay. Okay, sorry, question two, hopefully for all of us. So do we have to write about our accomplishments or can we just show our personality through the essay? I don't know if any of y'all want to chime in or if you want me to take that one. Seeing some good blank stares, so I will go ahead and speak to that. So do you have to write about your accomplishments? Not necessarily, because a college essay can be many different things. And I think for the Pitzer essay, the core value essay specifically does require you to write about your accomplishments or at least something that you're doing, right? I think that's kind of inherent to the prompt. But there are two other prompts. One of them is just a why Pitzer essay. So like, why are you applying to Pitzer? Why are you interested in this school? That might not necessarily bring in, you know, that might not read like a resume, right? And then the other prompt is a hypothetical. If you could do a project about an issue that's important to you, what would you do? That's also probably not going to bring in your accomplishments. So you don't necessarily have to. That's just where the core value essay tends to go. Another question is it okay if your writing naturally has a poetic quality to it, or is that something that I should try to limit? I don't know if our writing people here want to chime in. Yeah.
I can say something briefly, or Nikki, yeah, go for it. I'd like to hear
something. We might end up saying the same thing. So please go ahead.
Ah, Nikki's the poet, you should answer.
So what I was going to say, which maybe actually isn't what you're going to say on there, but and maybe the folks in the admissions office might have a different opinion on this, but at least at the Writing Center, what I've been telling people is that generally speaking, at least within the context of a lot of the college writing that I've done myself, as well as that I've seen at the Writing Center, that of course it varies by discipline and genre, like this being like applications being a genre. But generally speaking, when it's narrative based or like about yourself, that if you like in whatever way you find the most helpful to convey your own story and your personality and what you want to convey, that's what's most important. Of course, it is also very important to consider your audience. And so for some, perhaps writing more poetically might be, they might resonate with that more. With other people, it might not. So I think it really does depend on your audience, I would assume. But Andre or Alex or anybody, if you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, you're headed in the right direction for sure. I think that it's okay if your writing has that poetic quality. Like if that's just your voice in your writing, that's a great thing. The one thing I advise students about is just being careful about overdoing it in terms of the sort of like descriptive imagery that you might be adding to your essay. Some, like what we saw in essay two, is great. We love to see that. Sometimes students though can pivot and the whole thing can read almost like a work of fiction, right? Because it's become so flowery and so kind of entrenched in different metaphors and things like that. So I would just be careful. You know, you want to kind of sprinkle it in as a little sweet add to the story that you're telling. You don't want it to be the main thing that you're doing.
And for me, I feel like these two questions are related, which is it's a version of the question of what in the heck is a personal essay, like a college essay. It's like the personal statement, and my answer to this to students is it's not like an autobiography of you out there in the world. It's not creative nonfiction in that sense. It is strategic in a sense. It's you as an entering college as a student who wants to go to college at Pitzer, right? Like that's a very specific piece of you. And there are a million parts of our identities and our experiences. So it's thinking about highlighting what kind of person you want to be at Pitzer, what kind of research you want to do, what kind of community-based work you want to do, and highlighting that part of yourself, right? Because we could tell a million stories about ourselves depending on the audience and the context, but that's the context for this. And I can tell you, if I could go back to my college age self, you know, I was alone before the internet. It kind of, so I kind of did a creative nonfiction and I didn't get into my top school. And I feel like I missed an opportunity. Like I really missed an opportunity to showcase my interests and who I am. Because if you get too invested in a story that doesn't actually help us understand you as a student, interested in, with a set of values and a way of being in the world, we can't see you. In that context, then it's going to be harder for an admissions committee to go to bat for you, right? They're going to be looking elsewhere for all those pieces, whereas it's more strategic to have them also appear in the narrative.
Yeah, you got it. You could be doing my job now. That's exactly it. All right, so I have about three questions in a row here that I think I can probably answer quickly, but if any of my panelists want to chime in, just unmute yourself and I'll take that as an indicator that you want to add something to what I'm saying. So one of this says, should you focus on 2 to 3 examples or just one example in your Common App essay and in the Pitzer specific essay? For the Common App essay, honestly, that is an entirely different conversation. So I don't necessarily want to speak to that in this context, but at least for the Pitzer essay, definitely focus in. Like, I think that's what we were talking about in the difference between the first one and the second one is the first one has too many, like, then I did this and then I did this and then I did this. And the problem there is that you can't dig in, right? You can't really dig into what that meant for you and why you did what you did. So I think that having some focus and some specificity in your examples is definitely going to help to create that overall complexity to the essay that we've sort of been alluding to this entire time. The next question is it bad if my essay is more about what I want to do and less about what I've done? Definitely not. That is totally fine. One of the things that we in admission are very conscious of is that everybody has a different background. Not everyone had the opportunity to build solar ovens and to co-write a grant proposal for a sustainable garden while they were in high school. Like, I went to school personally in rural northern Arizona. None of that was happening. Like, I was just in choir and like doing my best. And so it's okay if your current life experience is not one where you're like, and then I did this, and then I did this awesome thing. It's okay to write about your aspirations. And I think that third prompt that I mentioned, the one that says like, if you could do work on an issue that's important to you, what would you do and why? That prompt is for you, my friend, to be able to write about what you would like to do and not just about what you have already done. But a big concern I hear from students, so I feel for you. The next question is it okay to include accomplishments that may be on your resume or activity section? It absolutely is. Like, there's bound to be some overlap between what you put on the activity section and what you put in your essays. I would just caution you again, when we're talking about essay one and how it's more of a list format, that list format, it ends up just reading exactly like the activity section. So just make sure that you're not having it, like if you hold them up next to each other, it should not be the same thing. It should be an expansion upon the activity section and not just a reiteration of that piece of your application. But it's okay if there's some overlap, like in terms of what you're talking about, that's totally normal. Just make sure that you're really adding something else to the narrative when you are writing about it. This next one is it okay for our personal essay and supplemental essay to revolve around the same topic in terms of our values? I'm not sure I know what this question means. I don't know if our other panelists have any thoughts. Personal essay and supplement essay. Oh, I see. So for the two essays to be about sort of the same thing, I get it. So for this, I'm going to say that yes, it's totally fine, especially if you're just like a super social justice person, like you are probably going to have some overlap between the Common App essay and the Pitzer essay. Just make sure you're trying to tell a little bit of a different story. You don't want them to be exactly the same. I have read essays where I'm like, this is just the Common App essay, but with some slightly different words for their Pitzer essay. That does not play well. So make sure you're submitting something that's pretty different. It's like an original piece of work that is not the same piece of work. I have even literally had students just copy paste their Common App essay into their Pitzer essay. That is a no-go. Don't do that. It's okay if there's overlap in terms of the values that you're talking about, though, because that's just who you are, right? So you can't control the fact that that's consistent throughout your personality, and that is okay. So our next question is, for the third prompt about a cause, I find it would be hard to write a personal narrative because it's about a vision. Is it okay to write objectively about what I am doing slash did and plan to do in order to drive that cause? Yes, absolutely. I think that it's okay if you're saying you're not reflecting on something you've already done necessarily. So it's a little bit of a different format. I do think that you can still maintain that narrative though in talking about like why you are connected to this issue. I see some nods from my writing people. I don't know if you guys have anything you want to add in terms of like maintaining a personal narrative, even though you're talking about something you haven't actually done yet.
Yeah, I really appreciated you saying, because I was thinking, oh my gosh, I did not have the privilege of the person in the second essay to have those kinds of opportunities or even maybe the confidence to pursue them at that moment in my life. But I feel like that perspective, that vision of what you want to do is that chance to say, also maybe begin by saying what you weren't able to do, to not linger there, but then to say, you know, tell us a bit about like why you're passionate about doing this other thing, right? And it's connected to values, right? It's how you would express them with the resources that Pitzer has at your fingertips to like enact that vision, to move forward on that vision.
Yes.
Yeah, and I would just add on to that by saying like I'm sure that there is a story behind what got you passionate about this. So even if that's not something you include, I think like knowing like what the connection is something that's important to explore in the process of writing this. It's like, why, like what stories like led up to you pursuing this kind of work and being so passionate about this? Like, I think kind of breaking down maybe like a few of the different pivotal moments or pivotal people that might have guided you in that direction can also make for more variety in terms of being able to pull from the narrative in the end that connects best.
Yeah, that's great advice. All right, so this next question is for y'all, which is, what are the unique elements of Pitzer's writing program and how do you become a writing fellow?
So can I say a few words about the first year seminar program and then the fellows talk about the Writing Center and your work in it? Would that be cool? Yeah, so the first year seminar, I'm like a big fan. I'm a champion of the first year seminar program. So Pitzer's writing program is unique in that you're taught by Pitzer faculty from across the disciplines. You have a chance, and the seminars are organized around consequential questions that have immediate relevance to social justice right now, right? And so you get to explore different topics and you get to use your writing to ask questions and enter really exciting intellectual debates. And I think that that's unique about our writing program, which means that no writing seminar is alike, which means you get to choose one that you gravitate towards, that ask questions that seem really exciting or interesting to you. And I will let our Writing Center fellows talk about the Writing Center, which supports the first year seminar program, but is distinct from it.
Yeah, so that's actually a perfect segue because I was nominated by my FYS professor to apply to be a fellow, which I learned is something, one of the amazing things about the FYS program is that in addition to, as Andrea said, strengthening your writing skills and really getting acclimated to the academic environment at Pitzer, they also support you in your writing, especially in terms of potential leadership positions. So I was nominated by my FYS professor, and then I applied, and the process was it was kind of cool. I think we turned in a sample of our writing, and then we engaged in some interviews that basically were mock sessions of what a Writing Center session would look like. So basically we were given what we just did in the session. We looked at it at an essay, or we looked at a piece, and as the mock fellow provided some feedback for the mock student on their paper. And so I guess in sum is basically like the process of becoming a fellow. Right now, at least, we're conducting all of our sessions virtually. But of course, usually they would be in person at the Writing Center, which is located, if you've been on campus, in Mead Hall, right at the center of Pitzer.
So you want to chime in, Em, and maybe just offer your experience about like what it's like to be a fellow? What does the peer tutor education program look like? What keeps you coming back to the Writing Center each year to do this work?
Oh man, that's just I could say so many different answers to that question, because like I said in the beginning, I'm just personally really invested in encouraging the power of storytelling and the ability to cultivate that skill, because it really does serve, as we've been saying so many times, so many aspects of your life. And as someone who is like a theater kid in high school and wanted to be able to translate those skills into activism work, I feel like writing and working with the Writing Center and working with people's creative works has been so fulfilling for me, because it's like the easiest way to connect with someone is to like hear their stories. Even if it's in an academic essay, it's like your voice comes out, your creativity gets to shine a little bit. And I think that that's, you know, one thing about college writing that's much better than high school is that you have more opportunity to write about things that you actually are passionate about and to have a little bit more creative freedom in the process of writing. So that's what keeps me coming back to the Writing Center. And especially this year, working with people on on fellowship applications, which is again a similar process to applying to college. You're kind of cultivating a narrative about yourself, trying to kind of sell yourself to whatever program you're applying to, talk about your passions in a really short space. So that's been even more fulfilling because it's like I get to actually really hear about people's stories. I would say that Pitzer has a really huge focus on like seeing students as the holistic, multifaceted like people that we are. And so I think that like that's why the focus on writing with the FYSs and the Writing Center really shines, because I think all of us as fellows are really coming at it, and Andrea for sure is training us to come at it from that holistic lens of like, we're going into these sessions not just coaching you on your writing, but like checking in on how you're doing and how we can support you best in this session, like, you know, in thinking in terms of that. And so the one other thing I'd add is that we also have so much student engagement on campus, and so like, for example, like we have 5 colleges, each of us have our own student newspaper, and there's a 5C student newspaper. So like outside of just the academic portion of writing and creating, like we have so many different outlets for you to express yourself, even if it's not going to fit into the format of an essay. So just also putting that out there, shameless plug, check out the outback.news. That's our student newspaper. Editor-in-chief.
Awesome. Thank you all so much for giving us that perspective on writing at Pitzer. All right, so we have a bunch more questions here, and I'm going to just start going through them. Again, very admission related, so I appreciate you guys kind of sitting tight while we get through those. So the first one is not actually about the essay. It's just apparently been coming up a lot in the chat about demonstrated interest in applying to Pitzer specifically. So is it unnecessary to email admission counselors just introducing yourself and show your interest in Pitzer? I want to show my interest in the school, but I don't have questions that haven't been answered from virtual events. Well, I'm very glad that we're answering all your questions such that you don't have any that you need to email in. That's always nice. You absolutely can just email yourself to introduce yourself to your admission counselor, even if you don't have a question. We like receiving those emails. Nothing bad can happen as a result of sending that kind of email to a Pitzer admission counselor or to any admission counselor. What I would say in terms of demonstrated interest is you don't need to worry about overdoing it. Like, you don't need to worry about, oh, this person's going to get tired of hearing from me, or they're going to do this or that, and that might affect my application. We're never going to penalize you for engaging with the college. So you can feel okay about doing whatever it is you want to do. Also keep in mind that if you're attending our virtual events, all of that's going to be considered as demonstrated interest. So you don't necessarily need to do more to try and get more out of it. It's kind of diminishing returns. Like, once you've engaged with us a couple of times via our virtual events, you've checked the box of like, they're interested, they've engaged with us, they've been here. So you don't necessarily need to keep trying to engage in more ways to strengthen your demonstrated interest. Next question is, if I want to play college softball, should I include that into my essay or focus on something else? I would say that in terms of your Pitzer supplement essay, softball is probably not the biggest focus unless you're going to write it about student engagement and you're going to talk about softball as one of your examples for that. In general, that kind of thing of like, I want to do this or I want to do that, you can make sure is in the activity section, right? So you can, or in the additional information section, two places where you get to just write kind of whatever you want about yourself. But if you're going to put down the high school softball that you played, right? And there's going to be little descriptions that you put of each activity. You can put like, I plan to play in college. If that's all you're really trying to communicate, you don't need to use the essay to do that. You can just communicate that more matter-of-factly. Next question is, Alex, you mentioned how some lines inspire you to fight for certain students to be admitted. What types of lines are those? I'm just going to give the easy answer here, which is any line that really resonates with our core values. That is what I am looking for. It doesn't need to be like a zinger. It doesn't need to be, you know, super clever or super funny. It's just when a student is showing that they are passionate, that they are involved, and that they really understand the core values. When there's pieces of the essay that show that, that is what I'm going to pull out and use in committee. So it's a pretty easy formula. Like, if you say something that speaks to our values, that is what's going to stand out for me. Next question is, you mentioned that most of the supplement essays responses are surrounding the core values prompt. Are you at a disadvantage if you answer a different prompt? Absolutely not. You can answer whatever prompt you want. We put them there for you. We will not penalize you for doing that. We added the additional prompts because we wanted students to have more options. So if having another option is what works for you, definitely go for it. Next question. My essay structure is completely different from the two examples. Is it better to change my structure similar to those? Not necessarily. Like, those are just examples of ways that you could write. I'm sure that all of our Writing Center people here would say that there is not one way to write a personal statement. There are many ways to write a personal statement. So those are just examples so that you could see some of the overall takeaways that we had of what made them a good versus a particularly excellent essay. And you don't need to go back and change what you've done just because it's not exactly like that. And then the last question I have here is, what if I don't have any good specific personal stories about community involvement or environmental sustainability? I would say that a lot of these students tend to write essays that are about interdisciplinary learning and they talk about their academics instead. That is also incredibly acceptable. You can go ahead and do that. And use that third prompt where you talk about hypotheticals, right? So that way you can look to the future and you don't necessarily have to linger on what you have or have not done in the past, would be my answer to those questions. But we are at 7:26 and that is the end of the questions that I have fed to me. My colleague Duan Duan will put some links in the chat right now of other ways that you can engage with Pitzer virtually. We have quite a few wonderful options. And I want to really thank our panelists here today. Thank you so much for giving an hour and a half of your time to talking with our Pitzer prospective students. I hope it was a helpful session for everyone. And I don't know if our panelists have any final comments you want to say or anything, but otherwise we are looking good to wrap up. Lots of thank yous in the chat.
Thank you for coming, everyone, for taking the time out of your busy schedules. Can't even imagine what it's like as a high school senior right now. So thank you for coming.
Yeah.
And we hope you all join us in the Writing Center and bring us your essays when your students mm-hmm. at Pitzer. We hold 1900 sessions per year with over 400 writers. So we'd love to see you for an hour consultation and hear more.
So many. That's wonderful. All right. Awesome.
Thanks for being here.
Oh, Kitty.
Good luck.
Thank you. Bye, everyone. Yep. Duan Duan just dropped the links one last time in case anyone wants to grab those. And I think with that, I will go ahead and end this Zoom webinar. Thank you, everyone.